Come on, can we celebrate Jesus with everything that we've got? This is the reason for the season, that grave could not hold him. Are you with me? Can we welcome our Fort Hood Killeen campus and just tell them how much we love them? Come on, let's just tell them how much we love them as they're joining us this Easter weekend, as well as our online campus, as so many are tuning in to watch and be able to receive. And my prayer for all of us today is that we will walk out of here forever changed, that we will walk out of here with an understanding like we've never had before, that we will walk out of here with a belief system that is deepened within our hearts of who Jesus really is. We kicked off this series titled I Am. It seems like two simple words, I am, but it's so much more deeper than that, and there's so much more to it than what meets the naked eye. When we look at the words I am, we see just two simple words, but inside of those words, Jesus said a lot of things that really would have to either make him crazy or would have to make him who he said he was. He said things like, I am the light of the world. He said, I am the Messiah, the chosen one, the Savior to all humanity. He said, before Abraham was, I am. To say those kind of things along with the one that says, I am the one who searches out the thoughts and the intentions of your heart. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I am the one who is, who was, and who is still to come, the Almighty One. When Jesus would make such bold declarations as that, either Jesus had to be crazy or he had to be, he has to be, he is who he said he is. But that's what we're going to look at today as we wrap up this I Am series on this Easter weekend, is we're going to look at the understanding of, if he is that, then why? Why did he come? Why did Jesus come? He is the great I Am. He is the one that was here before Abraham. He is the one that breathed life into the bones and the body of Adam and Eve. He is the one who gave creation all of its life. And that great I Am, the Son of the living God, chose to obey his Father and be sent to this earth. And the begging question is, why would he come? The religious, you see, they made it out to be an awful lot of what it wasn't. They were looking for a Messiah that would come on a white horse, not on a donkey. They were looking for a Messiah who would overthrow the Roman government, not who would submit himself to the law of the land. They were looking for a Messiah in their mind that was going to be like a Moses and deliver them from the time of persecution of the Roman Empire. But that's not what Jesus came to do. He did not come to deliver us from human hands. He came to deliver us from eternal hands. Are you with me? That is the message of Jesus, the great I Am. So when we ask ourselves, why did he come? Then we need to look and understand and see that he didn't come. He didn't come to try to fix the religious minded who thought they had it all together. There's this beautiful, beautiful story in Luke chapter 5 in verse 32. Why did he come? He said, I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, not those who think they have it all together, not those who think that what they've got doesn't stink, not those who think that they have no need of a Savior. But he said, I have come not to call those who think they are righteous, but I have come for those who know that they are sinners. Those who know they are broken. Those who know they are messed up. Those who know they've made mistakes. Those who know that they're not perfect and they need to repent.
All taxes must be paid in full.
We're all Jews. How can they live with themselves? Our own people working for Rome. These people make me sick.
Collaborators, let's move on.
I'm They're stinking vermin. You should keep your distance from them.
Two men went to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, and the other one a tax collector. The Pharisee prayed, "God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, thieves, adulterers, or this tax collector. But the tax collector didn't even look up to heaven. He said, 'God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. God bless the tax collector, not the Pharisee. Anyone who praises himself will be humbled. And anyone who humbles himself will be praised.'"
Matthew, come.
To follow him. One has to wonder of the sins committed by his other followers.
I don't know about you, but for me, that story rings so true in my heart. None of us were born free of sin. None of us were born Christians. We're all born into this world and we're all born into sin. And Jesus, he came. He came to save me. He came to save you. He came to give us a fresh start, a new beginning. He came in the humility of human form, all man, yet all God. He came to show us that even though we were still sinning, that he would give his life for us. And that would be the price for humanity to be restored, for mankind to have a choice, for each and every one of us here today. That would be the price that Jesus would pay. Jesus would have to give his very life for us. But why? It was because his sacrifice would create the only doorway into heaven. His sacrifice, his life given as a ransom, would be the only way for anybody to be able to enter into heaven from that day forth. That's why Jesus said in John 10:9, "I am the door."
devil from there!
Leave him!
Father! Father! Forgive them! For they know not what they do.
Even at death, at the point of utter annihilation to his body, he'd been beaten to the point where his mother couldn't recognize him. He'd been mocked, spit on, his beard ripped from his face, his flesh tore to where it hung like ribbons from his bones. I once showed a clip similar to this when I was a youth pastor to young people. We saw over 1,000 young people give their life to Jesus that night. And the religious society in the city raised up against me. How dare you show a rated R clip to young people? And I said, as graphic in nature as it was, what he went through was so more worse than we can ever portray on a movie screen. So I guess I just have to preach a rated R gospel. Are you hearing me today? We cannot shy away, lest we never forget the sacrifice that Jesus made for each and every person. Not just for each and every one of us, but even those who we despise, even those who frustrated us, even those who we would call our enemy at times. Jesus, he gave his life as a ransom for all. He paid the highest price that one could pay to be the ultimate sacrifice, so that whoever was just willing to believe and they would ask to receive the forgiveness he so dearly paid for with his life, that we could be redeemed, that we could be free, that we would be free from bondage, free from sin. Not that we would be perfect, not that we wouldn't make mistakes from that day forth, but now we have the power to overcome them. We have the grace of God living on the inside of us. As gruesome as his death was, as hard as it even is for us to watch, it didn't end there. The power was not just in the cross, but the power is what had happened 3 days after the cross. Because death, hell, nor the grave could hold him. This is why he could proclaim weeks before his death, "I am the resurrection and the life." That's the power that we celebrate this weekend. The power of the resurrection of Jesus. Death, where is your sting? Are you hearing me? Grave, where is your victory? He has risen. He is alive. We serve a God who can only make that declaration. We serve a Jesus that can only declare that one victory. No other religion, no other false God can lift themselves up that high to declare that they have risen from the dead. It is Jesus and Jesus alone who has had the power over death and the grave. He said, I hold the keys to them all. And what that means is that he holds the way to escape them. He would not just leave us after the resurrection. He would stay for 40 days. The Bible says after his passion, he stayed for 40 days teaching his disciples how to build the church. Not an institution, not a religious organization, but how to build the life-giving church that he said he gave his life for and that he would build through us. And when he built it, that the gates of hell could not prevail against it. That's why we at Reach Church, we don't want to follow man's model. We want to go right off the book of Acts because that's where Jesus teaches them what the church should be. But he also left us with a message of hope. He left us with a message of hope that he and he alone could declare. When he says in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
A cup. I need a cup and some wine.
What happened?
His body. His blood. I am the way. The truth. And the life. Thomas, stop doubting. Blessed are those who have not seen me, and yet have believed.
There's so many of us here today that can relate to what Thomas was going through. He wanted to believe, but he needed to see Jesus with his own eyes. That's where the expression comes from, doubting Thomas. But hear the words of Jesus. Blessed are those who have never seen me, yet still believe. Majority of humanity, they will never see Jesus face to face until the day that they meet him in heaven, when they have the opportunity to meet the Jesus living inside of each and every one of us. That's why it's so important. That's why it's so sacred. that we, as the Christian family, as a Christian faith, as a believer, that we show not perfection, but we show the passion and the realness of who Jesus is in us. Some today, you need to stop doubting and believe. Because the words of Jesus, that I am the way, the truth, and the life, are as true as any words he's ever spoken. History would show us and tell us that Jesus existed. You have a choice today. Either choose to believe he was crazy, or choose to believe that he is who he said he is, the Son of God, the Lamb of suffering that has come to take away all of your sins, all of your mistakes, every wrong you've ever committed, everything you've ever done that you've regretted, all the guilt, the shame, the weightiness, all that you carry. Jesus is here today to forgive each and every one. But you only have to believe that he is the only way. There is no other way. That he is the truth. There is no other truth. And that he is the life. There is no other life. When you came in today, there was a little bag on the seat before you sat down that has a little two-part communion. And we're to partake of that together here in just a moment. As we saw as Jesus entered into the house at the end there, that's what his disciples were doing. They were partaking in communion, where Jesus said, remember me in this. The bread represents my body. The juice represents my blood. And do this always in remembrance of me. Do it always in remembrance of him. So we're going to partake here on this Easter weekend here in just a moment together. But before we do, I want to give you an opportunity to set your heart right with Jesus. Because the scripture says that if our heart is not right with him and we partake of communion, that we are actually inviting his wrath upon us. Can we just bow our head, close our eyes here and at the Killeen campus, if you're watching online, wherever you're at, no matter what you're doing, just pause for a moment and reflect. Where do you stand with Jesus? His message is beautiful. It's the greatest message ever told. He promises you that if you'll just believe, if you'll take action on that belief and pray to him, acknowledge that he is the Son of God, ask forgiveness of your sins, of your mistakes, and confess with your mouth these things before others, then you will be redeemed. So I'm asking right here, right now, do you believe? Will you believe? Don't worry about anybody else that's around you. You worry about you and your eternity right now. If you're here and you want to say yes to Jesus, or you need to recommit a yes that maybe you once made, but your life is yet to reflect the decision that you made. You've stumbled, you've backslid, you've become lukewarm, you've strayed from the path. Then today, Jesus says, anyone that is willing to ask as many times as they will ask, I will forgive, for my mercy endures forever. If you're here and you want to say yes on the count of three, I'm going to ask you to put your hand up nice and high in the air. And then we're going to pray a prayer with you right there in your seat. And then we'll receive communion together after that prayer. If that's you, on three, put that hand up. One, two, three.